Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the plenary session. It's a great pleasure and honor for me to be moderating this first session. Yesterday evening, at the welcoming dinner, Deputy Prime Minister Garman very powerfully and I think eloquently outlined the challenges, the economic challenges of the rise of China. And I think today, in this opening plenary session, what we're dealing with is perhaps the strategic implications of the rise of China. I think for all of us, it's obvious that managing or dealing with adjusting to the emerging new relationship between China and the United States would be a critical component factor in the continued prosperity, peace of our respective countries, our respective sub-regions, and of course, Asia as a whole, and of course, the world. I think if I were to try to illustrate the importance of this Sino-US relations, seen from my own country, South Korea, as with many countries, but especially for South Korea, China is by far our largest trading partner. And our ties with China is, I think it's an experience that all of us here, our country, share. 25% of our trade export is with China. We have 70,000 Chinese students studying in South Korea. We have 70,000 South Korean students studying in China. It's a major relationship. At the same time, of course, we have a military alliance with the United States. So our security is vitally linked with the United States. Now, when U.S.-China relations are good, then of course we have the best of both worlds. We have a powerful military ally, and we have the most dynamic economy in the world, and we can do no wrong. But of course, when that U.S. bilateral relations become filled with tension, becomes more difficult, then we face some very serious difficulties. And if you allow me just one most immediate illustration of that for South Korea right now is in terms of dealing with the North Korean nuclear crisis that many commentators yesterday and today have already alluded to. It's an existential issue for South Korea. And being a violent security issue, our cooperation with the United States is critical. But for instance, even in terms of how we at South Korea prepare for an eventuality in terms of security arrangements, we began this discussion with our ally, the United States, in terms of bringing in this new anti-ballistic missile defense system, which of course, seen from a purely security point of view, is of vital interest to us. But from the Chinese perspective, it is seen by the Chinese leadership as having a potential to impinge upon China's own strategic interests. So we are in a situation where we need vital cooperation with both China and the United States in dealing with this existential security issue. But there are points at which bringing about that critical cooperation between the United States and China is not as easy as it would seem. So I'm just giving you one example of that. Now today, of course, we'll be discussing the concept of the new type of great power relations. I think Chinese leadership, especially President Xi Jinping, is very clearly aware potential difficulties in this relationship, and has given it a name, given that this new term and new concept, and which has actually spawned a veritable cottage industry, I think. If you Google this term, there are literally hundreds and hundreds of articles, and any commentator on foreign affairs and national security issue have commented on this. And so, but I think today we have what is perhaps the best possible experts and practitioners to address this issue, and I have a completely unenviable task of having the best practitioners and experts, and given only 70 minutes in which to have them, allow them to elaborate themselves and to engage the public, the audience here. So what I would ask everybody to do, all of our panelists, is to maybe use 6-7 minutes, 8 minutes, to have an opening statement, and then we'll open it up to the audience, and then we'll come back and give each of you 2 minutes towards the end. So I think a brevity and succinctness is the core concept here. And the order in which I would like to do this is first ask Minister Li Zhaoxing to elaborate from a Chinese perspective, and then I'll ask Dr. Jeffrey Bader to go right afterwards. Then I'll ask former Defense Minister Morimoto to go third, and Raja Mohan go fourth, and Dr. Natalegawa last but not least. And then we'll repeat that order. Minister Li Zhaoxing would like to make his opening address in Chinese manner. So if you would all like to put it into your translator, I think there's information up on the board as how to operate the mechanism. So without further ado, I'd like to invite Mr. Li Zhaoxing. You can do it sitting down, you can do it standing up, that's fine. Thank you. Please join me in welcoming.
尊敬的现在朋友，袁院长，尊敬的各位朋友，很高兴主持人愿意我用我的母语发言，因为我很高兴发现，中文在全世界，在我们这次重要关谈的领导国新加坡，都是说的人最多的语言之一。 只是要说一下我的中文，有点方言口音，就是山东方言，或者说有点控制的方言。亲爱的各位朋友，大家都很关心中美两国在亚洲的互动情况。美国是当今世界唯一的超级大国，中国。 这是世界上最大的发展国家，两岸关系的好坏直接影响了亚洲局势。近一段时期以来，国际上关于中美矛盾和分歧的议论较多，有人担心中美是否会陷入冲突，甚至战争，也就是所谓的休斯顿协定。总体而言，中美关系稳定的。 中美关系不同于冷战时期的苏美关系，没有那种你死我活的意识形态对抗。相反，中美两国之间有着巨大的共同利益，这个共同利益还在继续增大，这就给中美关系这艘巨轮提供了压舱石。 中国去年已经是美国最大的贸易伙伴，两国贸易额达到5580多亿美元，中美两国间的往来达到475万人次。 中美两国已经建立起100多对对话共同渠道，正在就朝鲜半岛、河北、阿富汗地区合作等开展对话合作。 坦率地说，美国近来在亚太采取的一系列动作，让我们感到困惑，让人担心。美国总统奥巴马在跨太平洋战略经济伙伴关系签订签署之后说，不能让中国来实现21世纪国际经济规则，对抗的味道比较浓。
这与中国成立亚投行的开放态度形成了鲜明对比。在中国支持下，联合国安理会通过涉朝鲜的227号决议后，美国还立即推动在韩国部署萨德导弹系统，严重威胁中国的战略安全。这就在中国的背后。
通道，南海不是中美之间的问题，却成为中美之间最突出的问题。中国加强南海岛礁建设，是在自己的领土主权范围内做事，完全正当合法。但是美国入列大敌。
频频的说三道四，支持和孤立其他国家向中国施加压力，制造南海紧张气氛。实际上，美国与中国的职责是站不住脚的，而且他也自相矛盾。美国指责中国在南海搞军事化，但中国的领土一直。 在其战略中国岛礁上扩建机场，部署各种经济性武器，与这些美国却视而不见。美国要求中国遵守国际法，遵守联合国海洋法公约，而美国自己呢，到现在也没有签署这个公约。美国声称。 在南海问题上，不宣称战略，对各国主权主张不持立场。但近来，美国国务院军方人士却公开、频频地表示，说中国的主权主张不符合国际法。中美当前之所以有一些矛盾的问题比较突出。 在我个人看来，主要是美国方面对中国的发展进步不放心、不适应。美国有个别政客认为，国强必霸，中国强大了将确定美国在亚洲世界的地位，甚至说中美难民战。
这是典型的冷战思维和霸权逻辑，应到我们中国身上，应到我们爱好和平、坚持走和平道路的中国身上极其不合适。中国政府把搞好自己国内的发展作为第一要务，我们现在的经济能量。 虽然是世界第二，但按人均计算，我们的人均国内生产总值在全世界90个国家当中，它排在第80位之后。我们的人均国内生产总值仅相当于美国的
不断创新，推动区域合作取得更多的
更大的承诺。上个月，月底举行了南长江湄公河合作的首次领导人会议，这又是中国和东盟合作的一个新的平台，将由于东中企的均衡发展。第四，我们愿意把东盟作为上合组织的
优先伙伴，共同维护好南海的和平稳定，加强在海洋经济、海洋环保、海上安全等领域的合作，使连接中国和东盟的海洋成为游鱼之海、合作之海、繁荣之海。我们也希望包括美国在内的其他域内外国家 都能够允许合作共赢的思想，共同为实现和平繁荣的亚洲来贡献力量和智慧。谢谢，亲爱的各位朋友，谢谢。Thank
you, Mr. Zhaoxing.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's a very great honor and a great humble opportunity to be on a platform with three former senior ministers, all friends, and a distinguished analyst and journalist, as a former humble senior director of the White House. As the U.S. looks at Asia, it sees the most dynamic and fastest growing part of the world, with chaos, civil war, and anarchy in much of the Middle East. Sovereign borders being reached in Europe, grinding poverty in Africa, and major economies in Latin America in state of economic stagnation. Asia's a major success story, not only in relative but in absolute terms, in economic achievements and in avoiding major military conflicts for over a generation. Through the so-called rebalance, the Obama administration is signaling its intention to be an even bigger part of the Asian success story going forward. And given what Asia has achieved, the U.S. has certainly no interest in screwing it up and making it look like a lost war. What do Americans see when they look at Asia? First, it's a region that does not look at all strange or alien to Americans. Some of our principal security allies and partners are in the region. There are 18 million Asian Americans. It's about 5 or 6% of the American population. Indeed, I hope that they will decide the election this fall. If they do, it will be a good outcome. For better or worse, we've been involved in three major wars in Asia in the last 75 years. Millions of Asians have attended our universities, the student bodies of which now look more Asian than European in many elite schools. To illustrate, one cannot imagine a Silicon Valley without the innovations and the contributions in the lives of Asians and Asian Americans. Second, it's a region where the U.S. has textured relationships with Japan, with India, China, Korea, and the ASEAN countries. What brings us together is much more significant than what separates us. Trade and investment, supply chains, science and technology innovation, universities and education, people-to-people connections, sports, the arts, fashion, design, and many countries' social security tasks. Third, it's a part of the world where Americans and American presidents feel welcome. In years of living in and visiting Asia, I have never personally encountered anti-Americanism. Now, maybe you think I've led a sheltered life, and I don't dismiss the toxicity of and the vitriol of the internet, but everyone, not just America, is the target of the mobocracy, countries in cyberspace. With this important background, let me turn to the core question that the conference organizers asked us to speak about, namely how the US and China can and should coexist and interact in the 21st century. I want to be clear at the outset, my profound admiration for what China has accomplished in the 35 years since I first visited China. And it's done so in the face of staggering challenges and difficulties. When I went to China with President Mohan in 2009 for his first visit, I had lunch with Premier Wen Jiabao, who explained to him the challenges he was working on, bringing 10, 12 million people from countryside to cities each year, trying to find employment and housing and transportation for them, building social safety net, trying to maintain growth at near double-digit levels, trying to prevent China from running out of water, et cetera, et cetera. President Obama listened and said, I thought I had a difficult job. I wouldn't want your job. And he meant it. China is now an important pillar of the global system and the global economy. It plays a growing role in all the major international organizations that we normally describe as foundations of the international system, the United Nations, the United Nations Security Council, the WTO, the WHO, the NPT, the IAEA, anti-piracy, anti-cooperation, anti-counterterrorism cooperation, and cooperation on climate change. I do not see China as the richest power on a global level. As its leaders have said, China has been a major beneficiary of the global system. So does China's interest to support it. In Asia, the picture is somewhat more complex. On the one hand, China has become the hub of an integrated Asian manufacturing and supply chain, which has benefited almost all of Asia. It is evident, however, that China's rise over the last decade has caused anxiety in the security domain among its neighbors and the United States, particularly as its military spending and capabilities have far outstripped its neighbors. I would be remiss if here in Southeast Asia, I did not speak about the issue that has been looming large these past 4 years, namely maritime disputes. This is not the inconsiderable region on the verge of serious conflict, or these are the most important issues in our relationship, but they cannot be ignored. China's ambitious, ambiguous, and in some instances, legally questionable maritime claims in the South China Sea have entangled it with other claims and even with regional non-claims. There was great wisdom in the guidance attributed to Deng Xiaoping some years ago, Taiwan Yang Hui, translated roughly as be patient and exercise restraint. As late as 2010, Dai Jiguo reminded the Chinese of the advantages this principle brought to China as first. Those days right now seem long past. Until China settles on a new equilibrium, based on a framework of justice-wise, it will appear that there will be frictions, expectations of a strong U.S. military presence on the part of our allies and partners, and I would stress a positive response by the U.S. to such expectations. On the other hand, we have to be aware there is also the risk of a security dilemma in which hardliners on both sides see a valid basis for their policies in the words and activities of the others. That has to be resisted by people of goodwill in the US and China. The good news is there has not been a significant military clash in the South China Sea for decades, and no attacks on land features controlled by other parties. Shipping insurance rates are stable. But there has been an increasing militarization, which is why Xi Jinping suggests that the spread is not being militarized as well received. Actions by China consistent with that intent will be essential, and unfortunately they have not been evidenced today. Building artificial islands with transparently evidenced military force projection capabilities are not evidence of a halt to militarization. The U.S. should encourage all claimants to show restraint and to honor the letter and spirit of the Declaration of Conflict and tribunal decisions. In the meantime, the U.S. can expect to signal through its diplomacy and its military deployments that a creeping change in the status quo through threat of coercion and maritime claims inconsistent with international law are unacceptable. Elsewhere, the U.S. and China show signs of moving toward a common view of a threat to regional security posed by Kim Jong-un's North Korea, which remains the most dangerous flashpoint in the area. That is a good thing. We all need to make clear to Pyongyang that it will have no wiggle room if it continues to build and maintain a nuclear arsenal. It has to be forced to pay a high price that compels it to reconsider. Trilateral cooperation among Pakistan, President Obama, and Xi Jinping, and their success will be essential to attain this objective. Japan also has an important role in providing deterrence and resources. Having been involved in the U.S.-China relationship for decades, I'm honest. Neither the U.S. nor China seeks conflict, and leaders on both sides do not want the relationship to descend into unadulterated rivalry. I think our governments are more capable of managing the relationship and driving towards constructive ends than many outside observers believe. The meeting yesterday in Washington between Presidents Obama and Xi, one of only two bilaterals held by President Obama, marks as a new security summit among the 52 leaders gathered there, is an important sign the leaders are committed to making the relationship work. Let me close with another modesty. I've talked about what I think others should do. The U.S. has responsibilities too. Watching the U.S. presidential election these last few months, one can be forgiven for thinking that two generations of American statesmanship, global engagement, and leadership and two centuries of democratic governments are a thing of the past. My congenital optimism reminds me of what that honorary American citizen Winston Churchill said, that Americans can always count on to do the right thing after trying everything else. That's what we've been doing this year. So I look forward to coming back to Singapore toward the end of the year, to say that that wisdom and my prediction has been validated. I'm confident that will happen, painful as the process may be toward what I predict will be that happy ending. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Dr. Bader. Quickly, we'll move on to Minister Morimoto, please. If I may, we're running out of time. And if you could make it as 7-8 minutes.
It's a great pleasure to be invited to this famous forum and given the opportunity to make my remarks and exchange views with distinguished participants on this occasion. I'm a policy advisor to the Defense Minister of Japan. I used to be a Defense Minister of the Democratic Party in Japan, but now I'm working for the LDP, Liberal Democratic Party, that is a major reform. I would like to make a short opening remarks on the major part relations and roles by raising two cases. One is on such chances, and another is on nuclear missile development and proliferation issues, especially of DDR. First of all, Raden may be defined as a nation which can play a major role in contributing to secure a stable world order. It does not mean necessarily a nation with large territory and population. For example, UK and France used to be a great power in modern history. China has been insisting to come new types of major power relations with the United States since 2013. Although the United States did not accept this front as long as I know, we have to take a look at very carefully how any great power is contributing to secure an international order based on the international law. Now, turning to the such chances. The China has been making a territorial influence and advancing large-scale non-information and construction project of military assets and deploying military there. These activities are absolutely inconsistent with the remarks of Chinese leader Mr. Xi Jinping, which were made at the news conference in September last year in Washington, indicating not to use this declaration for military purposes. These declarations have been a concern among most of the nations of the region. The China should indicate the clear-cut evidence of territorial play, not only in the China Sea, but also in the China Sea as well. The China also has been constructing additional offshore platform in the East China Sea, and dispatching around the 3.4 vessels every month in the territorial water of Senkaku, which is an imminent part of territory of Japan, Yuari, and Isukai. And most of our Asian countries are worried about the militarization to change the status quo in this force, and we will be involved. Possible conflict between major powers, especially in the Blue Ocean of Asia Pacific region. Another serious concern in Asia is the nuclear missile development, testing, and proliferation of DPRK. DPRK has both part of nuclear tests in last January, and the Tepodon's modified version launching in last February. The US and China have intensively negotiated. Intensive negotiation to pass through the United Nations Security Council resolution in March. Now the USRK began a large scale of our joint military exercise on March 8th, and with the end of this month, the USRK had various kind of provocation by launching a missile into the Syrian farm. We have very serious concern this kind of provocation. We have to intensify the reconnaissance and surveillance capability of activities, especially between the end of a joint exercise between the US and the UK. And also DPRK labor party, which is scheduled on May 9th. We hope both US and China will cooperate, will encourage the DPRK to sit down at the table of six-party talks, maybe by rethinking the mandate of six-party talks in a more comprehensive way, and to seek for the denuclearization of the peninsula. play an important role to deter and react the various kinds of propagation of the attack. Last year, we believe that the US military presence and commitment is the most crucial stabilizing factor to secure the peace and stability in the region. Japan and the US modified the defense cooperation guideline and approved the peace and security legislation which allowed Japan to exercise limited collective self-defense might and to improve at least support to the US forces under certain conditions. We hope new political leader of the United States will manage the US-China relations to be more stable, and the US will take a more powerful political leadership so that the other Asian nations can enjoy a stable and peaceful environment in the region. We, US allies, have support and assist to enhance U.S. operational capability more than before, and to improve alliance. These efforts are necessary wherever will be the next political leader. Just I would like to raise Mr. Trump's remarks. Mr. Trump, as you know, Republican candidate continue to make a provocative remarks, which some of them are not reasonable in a security sense, especially unilateral and unequal nature of the alliance. However, look at the article 6 of the US Japan Mutual Security Treaty, Japan and US forces to take access and to use base and area in order to secure peace and stability of bias, not only bias, but also Japan. Our government made a best effort to maintain the US forces and US bases stable and operationally stable and in order to implement this effort, we made a large scale of political risk and economic cost. To make US forces and the US bases operations. Also, we allocate a huge budget of post-military support. This year, we spent 190 billion yen, it's almost 1.2 billion US dollars. That is the largest financial contribution of US allies. Also, in order to offset this unilateral nature of US Japan security treaty, we spend a lot of money to purchase the US military equipment, including Hawaii, QPN, 35, its shield, its D, and Patriot, Aegis, Osprey, Global, M7, and AIBM Tanga. We spend almost one third of a total defense equipment budget to the HMS that is purchase military equipment from the United States. It's almost 12 billion US dollars this year. But on that, some small scale defense business in order to offset this nature of alliance, we devised the US Japan Defense Cooperation Guideline. As I said, we passed through the peace and security legislation to offset additional support to the United States. I would like to emphasize how much the US allies nations effort to offset the unilateral nature of the alliance makes the United States more useful and profitable, a significant contribution to US economic interests. I think in general, allies relations should be sought out in a comprehensive way. That is the most important point which I would like to emphasize. And lastly, however, the many American people agree upon the strategy pass, but we have to take a consideration very carefully why. Whoever becomes US president next year, how much American people are complained and are satisfied because the US may believe that the contribution of the peace and stability of international security we are equal and critical. We have to see for the how to secure and reinforce alliance in the future. I would like to discuss this issue.
Thank you, Mr. Raden. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Raden. It's a privilege to be part of this very high panel. Unlike my colleagues on the panel, I'm not really a formal minister, nor really am I much secretary, official, but I believe that gives me some freedom to speak more directly and more frankly. To the issue that I involved in the debate on the new model of great power relations. What I'm trying to do in the limited time that I have is to address three sets of issues related to the changing nature of our great power relations. One is about the context in which we are talking about. Two, what is the content in terms of various direction of US-China relationship that's going to take? And third, what does it mean for the rest of us in Asia? And what is it that we need to do to deal with this turbulent uncertainty in the US-China relationship? So coming to the context, quite clearly, this is about the rising China and its implications for the future of American primacy in Asia. And then the expansion of Chinese power, though the most important developing country, it's a very developing country, the second largest economy, the second largest defense budget, and that irrespective of individual incomes, I mean, the collective weight of China is decisive, it's going to be significant, and it's going to have an effect on the American policies in this region, and I think we've got to deal with it. America and China have been adversaries in the 50s and 60s. They were partners against the Soviet Union in the 70s and 80s, and in the last two decades, they've been uneasy rivals, but at the same time, deeply interconnected through economic relationship. So it's a very complex relationship, and what happens here is going to be quite different from many of the other things we've known in our lifetime, especially in terms of the US-Soviet relationship. Now, I think the debate, we've got to understand the Chinese proposition or the Chinese call for a new model of a great power relationship actually must be seen in the context of what the Americans were saying a decade ago. It was Deputy Secretary of State, Robert Zelig, who said, China must be a responsible stakeholder. He was celebrating the fact that America had brought China into the global institutions, and now it was time for China to strengthen this global system by being a responsible stakeholder. The reaction of Chinese is quite interesting. They said, I think, it's my interpretation. Thank you, but no thank you. That this is not about you running a club and you letting me in, and I'm here to go by your rules. The Chinese are saying, we've been a great power before, we were sent to the universe, and we just made an eternity. And therefore, this idea that we are never going to accept the rules of the pre-existing club, which is what an assumption many of us have made. And I think the Chinese are saying, sorry, we got our own ideas of how we want to organize the system. We didn't write these rules, so therefore, don't pin us down and say, here are my rules, are you going to sign on the club membership? And then the Chinese are not going to accept any test by anybody else, and they are going to set their own rules. So in many ways, this idea of a new model of great power relationship is actually Chinese terms and conditions of what should be the relationship between the Americans and the Chinese. The American presumption was, here is be a responsible stakeholder. The Chinese are saying, here is what we want in a new model of great populations. So essentially, the debate, when you cut through all the fluff around it, it's essentially about the terms of engagement. This is not what I think. I think both of them want an accommodation, want some kind of an understanding, because both recognize any confrontation between them would be disastrous for both of them and for the world. Therefore, it is a question of terms. As it's not about the principle, it's about terms of what are the terms of engagement between the two. And I think the terms of engagement is where the trouble is. And that's going to involve the definition of each other's core interests, it's going to involve the nature of American alliances. It's going to involve the nature of the American military presence here in Asia. All these are issues that are going to be debated by the two sides. So therefore, how this negotiation or contestation of to find an accommodation, how that play out, that brings me to the second part of the presentation, that's on where would this go, where might this go. My sense is a whole range of possibilities exist. We could have a channel in the Asian order. People criticize Trump, but if Trump says, look, I've had enough, bye-bye, we will have a channel in Asian order. And I think Chinese also always talk about Asia for Asians. I don't know if everybody welcomes it, but it's interesting. I believe you've heard that before. The second, it could be a confrontation, because Americans said, we're not leaving. We're not going to cede our stakes in this part, and we're going to challenge any attempt to push us out. Then you have a confrontation. They could be the third possibility of a condominium. The two of them could come to a new model of American power relations. Essentially, work out a deal in which they could say, these are our rules, big boys work out our rules, and we're going to enforce these rules on others. Just as we don't like confrontation, I'm sure many of us are not going to like condominium either. But that's one possibility. There could be other ways in which the cookie can be cut. It could be spheres of influence. One of the Chinese advocates of the American stay east of Hawaii, if you have any problem, give us a phone call. Now, there are ways in which this could work itself out, but my senses are that something is going to give. Because this is a villain of his city, he wrote recently that China is a geographic reality in this part. America. Is that a geopolitical calculation, the term that I use. And the calculation depends fundamentally on the nature of the political consensus in the United States. It's easy for us, those of the technocrats, policymakers, think tankers, to scoff at Mr. Trump. But America still remains a democracy. And if the political center of gravity in the United States shifts away from maintaining the burdens of the world, we are going to be at a different juncture. So it's not what Trump thinks. It's not very different from what Mr. Sanders says. I mean, style of expression, of course, is very different. And it's not very different from what even Obama was saying in his article, those of you read it, in Atlantic Monthly article, where he's saying, look, the allies are free riders. I mean, why are they doing more? So that's a question everyone is asking in the US. Barring the individual who kind of stick to the center, the rest of them are making an argument, which I think we want to pay for. The Americans are not going to stay here because of the thinking tanks in the belt they wanted, but it is going to be on the basis of the cost calculation by the American people. And I think how this election goes, that's why it's going to be very important. But for those of us here in this part of the world, sitting here in Singapore, at least you've got to think of two important moments that happened here before. One was the fall of Singapore in 1942. Those who believed the Raj was unchallengeable, immovable authority in this part of the world, surprised to see how quickly Raj had back at the banks and leaving in 1942. But of course, the British Raj came back at great cost. But then 20 years later, at least at the moment, for all the assurances that Great Britain was giving its Asian partners in the 60s, we're not going to leave Asia. There's no question of us leaving Asia, and it's scary to announce the East of Suez. So I think, irrespective of what the current think tanks, current reports of think tanks might say, we've got to be prepared in Asia for a fundamental change in the structure of power in this part of the world, and I think dealing with that must be a priority for all of us. And let me hearsay that already beginning to see something's beginning to happen. Countries are beginning to spend more on their defense. People are expanding their military capabilities. People are working with each other. India, Japan could have worked together, which they did not work before. Japan is helping Philippines. Vietnam, Australia work together. So what you have is, in the context of a changing dynamic here, there is going to be expanded network of cooperation in this part of the world, and I think that's going to be very, very important. And my sense is, unlike in the earlier Cold War, where you're merely passive players in the Cold War, for some of us in the name of non-alignment offered passive resistance, but this time around, every one of us will have to operate to deal with the potential structural change in the balance of power in this part of the world. So let me just conclude by saying, whatever Mr. Trump is saying, whatever Mr. Sanders is saying, whatever Mr. Obama is saying, we got to take more responsibility. We don't have the luxury of merely saying, Americans and Chinese will do the right thing, and then criticize them for whatever they do or they don't do. That luxury is over. So I think Asia, we have to take more responsibilities, and especially large countries like India and Japan. We'll have an Indonesia. We'll have to take more responsibility, and I think that's where the real challenge is. And I would say, this is also an opportunity. But those countries which claim themselves to emerging powers like India, it's an opportunity to demonstrate the capacity they're willing to put the money where their mouth is, to show they will really take leadership in constructing new institutions that are stabilizing Asia. And finally, somebody raised the question of South Asia this morning. Let's not forget, the Second World War in this part of the world was not won without the participation of the resources of the antivirus subcontinent. It was the armies of the subcontinent that moved the Japanese out of South Asia. It was also the armies of the subcontinent and its financial resources that went into supporting China during the Japanese occupation. So let's not think it's a mere Northeast Asian game or East Asian game that South Asia will, and India in particular, will have to play a critical role in shaping the future of our world. Thank you.
Please join me in one moment.
New model of great power relations. I have a little bit of observation on some of the terminology that has been used. The concept of new in a region, this part of the world I believe, change is permanent. We are seeing constant evolution, constant dynamism. So I think it would be impossible to sort of freeze frame the current constellation and assume that this will be good to go for the many years to come. In my view, the perspective that we must adopt is to recognize that a change in this part of the world, geopolitical, geoeconomic, is a permanent feature, and we must devise an architecture for the region that is inherently adaptive, inherently able to adjust to changing events. Change, therefore, is permanent. Whatever new model is being proposed, I can guarantee it will become obsolete as soon as it is formally adopted. So I believe actually our region would thrive even more if we recognize change as a given and begin to address the challenges with that kind of mindset. The second footnote that I have with respect to the theme is the concept of great power. You can accuse me of being somewhat idealistic, but I do believe honestly, that there is no real monopoly of wisdom in terms of one, how one addresses the challenges of this region. What makes this region what it is, in my view, especially for the future, is to enable, empower, and make possible the contributions of all powers, large and small, because I do believe the concept of great power is so 20th century that doesn't belong in the 21st century, when countries large and small can and must actually bring their contribution in addressing challenges in our region. Change is permanent, and all powers, countries large and small, can make a contribution. I am struck by how previous discussions have been had. The focus has been principally on US-China dynamics and how that it may impact on our region. Because of the constraints of time, I simply wish to flag that, by the way, apart from US-China dynamics, there are other equally important dynamics that are yet to find its full fruition and manifestation. US-Russia, I am told, I read somewhere that there is concept of fear or concern of a new Cold War, at least in the European, Central European theater, perhaps finding its manifestation in the Middle East nowadays. If we are not careful, we may see a return or projection of such dynamics in this part of the world, certainly something that we wish not to see. Northeast Asia has its own unique dynamics. Japan, China relations, Japan, Korea relations, apart from the obvious North Korea and the Korean Peninsula situation. Southeast Asia has its own dynamics. Does ASEAN matter? How can ASEAN deliver on its centrality beyond becoming simply a mantra to be recited? The Indo-Pacific matters. It's not only a geographical construct, it is a geopolitical and geoeconomic space as well. In other words, what I'm trying to suggest is that whilst, of course, China-US relationship is terribly important, at the same time, there are other kinds of dynamics within our region that must be addressed and anticipated. All of them are unique in their own unique circumstances, situations, and again, at the risk of caricature, I'd like to suggest that there are at least a 3+1 challenges. One is the challenge of trust deficit. Whether it's in US-China, Northeast Asia, even Southeast Asia, Indo-Pacific, despite the industry of proliferation of various conferences, think tanks conferences, there is still inherently a trust deficit between the societies and the countries concerned. Second, territorial disputes. South China Sea, the obvious one, East China Sea, even other bilateral territorial disputes. Thirdly, in fact, the challenge that our region is replete with challenges that are transboundary, transnational, 21st century in nature, and yet our instruments are very much 20th century. How can we equip this region with the kind of wherewithal in dealing with transnational and transboundary issues? And last but not least, geopolitical shifts and changes. Seeing in geopolitical shifts and challenges as a threat, I think it is not particularly useful. The notion of balance of power, structure of power, I think is very much 20th century concept, when we should be striving, in my view, for an equilibrium that is dynamic, that is inherently adaptive, inherently recognizing the changes in our region, but at the same time having an element of stability as well. Five steps that I'd like to suggest ahead of us, again, the risk of caricature. Step one must be confidence building and trust building. There has to be greater, urgent, and more real, realistic efforts at trust building in this part of the world. The second step, and I think this has to be done by ASEAN, and it is being done with the East Asia Summit, a treaty commitment to the non-use of force. Are countries of this region, East Asia Summit in particular, are we ready
to declare and to make a treaty commitment to renounce the use of force in settling disputes among them. This we did in ASEAN, and this we have begun to do in the ECC Summit through the Bali Principles of 2011. The third step, I must ask you to volunteer, is the concept of crisis management. How can we have a modality where crises can be addressed and be managed and not allowed to proliferate to become more serious? The fourth is how we promote 21st century partnership. How can countries of this region deal with issues that are transboundary in nature? We have a lot to share and a lot to compare. Look at the wonderful transformation that's been taking place in this part of the world, in Myanmar, just a few weeks and a few days. We've seen fundamental transformation taking place peacefully. Contrast what is happening in the Middle East, the so-called Arab Spring, which has developed the way that it has. Fifth and final suggestion I'd like to make is for us within the East Asia Summit process to establish a Peace and Security Council of the East Asia Summit. The East Asia Summit already brings together ASEAN 10 and the key partners of this region. The leaders meet once a year, September, October, November. The foreign ministers meet back to back with the leaders and an annual foreign ministers around July. But the East Asia Summit cannot be a hello and goodbye forum, a procedural and formal in nature only. I'd like to propose that the permanent representatives of the ASEAN and the East Asian countries that are now already assigned within ASEAN should organize themselves to a Peace and Security Council of the East Asian Summit so that they can deal regularly on issues of development in our region. And in that way, the habit of cooperation in our region can be better promoted. Thank you very much.
Thank you, I have completely been unable to contain the great powers and would be great powers in terms of controlling the time, length of the time of their speech. We only have a couple of minutes, but with the indulgence of the organizers, I would like to quickly gather three questions from the audience and then very quickly give each of you, our panelists, 1 minute each to answer them. Are there questions? If you please raise your hand. There's microphone number 5. If you could quickly identify yourself, ask a question, and of course tell us to whom you're addressing.
My name is Song Yuni from Central Ministry of Security from South Korea. My question is for Minister Li Zhaoxing. You are from Shandong province, the birthplace of Confucius, also the origin place of Jin Zi, virtuous person. The definition of virtuous person is that, based on my Chinese understanding, is that you should not just judge his words, but also look at his actions. So in China's behavior of becoming playing the role of responsible stakeholder, you often get confused between China's official rhetoric and speeches and actual Chinese actions. For example, in North Korea, China said it is going to basically implement UN sanctions. But sometimes we tend to scratch our heads and how it is really implemented. So could you teach us that Chinese philosophy of how it is implementing its responsible stakeholdership, for example, on the North Korean issue? Thank you.
If you can hold that, we'll collect two more questions and we'll give you a chance. Anybody else? Please, gentlemen,
number 6. Thank you. Indian Council of Oil and Energy. I am grateful to Minister Natalegawa and to Raden Mohan for expanding the scope of this discussion. I'm glad that Asia is now defined as including South Asia, West Asia. Because it is not adequate to talk about South Asia. I think the important thing is this is not a region that is open just to power. I think we need an international, Indo-Pacific security architecture, as you mentioned on the other side, which is dynamic, but ensures equilibrium, and which ensures openness, equal security for all. It has to be transparent and inclusive. I think that is the importance of this debate, not just simply reducing it to a pattern or a new great power relationship between an existing great power and a rising great power. I think maybe the others are not so important to address this. How do they look at the evolution of the new Asian security architecture?
Thank you. One last question. Number five. My name is Yogi Chato from Japan, Rebuild Japan Foundation Initiative. I have a question to Mr. Li Jiangqi. It seems to me that the new type of major collaboration which has become only a liability for the bilateral relationship between the United States and China rather than an asset, because the United States has, as Mr. Morimoto pointed out, the United States has already made it clear that they do not want to work on it on the terms that China has demonstrated. And namely, the biggest problem seems to be the assertion of China to for a mutual respect for the core interests. And this is exactly what Raden Mohan pointed out, the terms, in terms of the engagement. So, and the recent talks between two countries, including President Obama and President Xi, while President Xi uses this term, President Obama never uses this term anymore. And in this session, Mr. Beja didn't use it. So what makes China still think it's workable? It seems to me, unless you modify the notion or take back the assertion of the mutual respect for core interests, I don't think it's going to work. Can you enlighten us why you think it's still workable? Thank you.
Okay, so thank you. We have 2 minutes left. They actually gave us 2 minutes. Thank you. But can we start with the Minister Li Jiangqi first again and go through the same order? And you have 30 seconds each.
How much time do I have?
1 minute. 30 seconds for 1 minute.
So every half a second counts.
Thank you.
很高兴遇到韩国朋友和日本朋友的问题。关于韩国朋友的问题，我想强调的是，我们两国自从1992年。 建立了关于朝鲜的，我个人不知道中国韩国特色，就是因为韩国语言太难学了，我只说标准的一句话，什么思密达，谢谢你。问题是，朝鲜半岛问题非常复杂，但是中国的立场非常简单明了，就是朝鲜半岛的任何一方。 都不得严罚，拥有、部署和进口核武器，就是说，朝鲜半岛应该实现无核化，而且各方都曾经答应做到这一点。那么，根据你所提到的，孔子我的老乡的话，就是言无信，行于默。 言而无信，特征要你说不要核武器的，你就要真的不要。这是为什么？朝鲜民主人民共和国最近试验核武器，试验的代表，我们表示明确的、坚决的反对。同时，我们也希望各方都能够克制、理智，也是说话算数，大家都说。 朝鲜无核，半岛无核化，为了和平，为了半岛的和平，那么好，为了和平，你要不要利用游击方面出的问题为借口来做不利于和平的事？比如说，由于朝鲜大国，联合敌对国家，要在半岛上部署萨德导弹，说是为了对付北朝鲜。 实际上是真的吗？不要以
Sure, a few thoughts on Korea. But when I was in office, I came into office with the thought that perhaps we could make some progress on the nuclear program. I was quickly disabused that much in a few months by the missile tests and nuclear tests. People were saying just to get back to the six-part talks. I came to the what's the point of going back to the six-part talks if North Korea had no interest whatsoever in non-agreements that they made in 2005. Growing the six-part talks, all they were going to do was take their violations in 2005 and make that a new basis of talks going forward. And that was quite the point. Basically, that's what's mine, what's yours is mine. That's the negotiated strategy. So we changed course. I believe that the resolution adopted by the Security Council in the last couple of months, negotiated by the US and China, offers the greatest hope we've seen in quite some time for making real progress with North Korea, because the sanctions actually have bite, and if they are implemented by all parties, then North Korea will feel the pain. If ships and airplanes, cargoes are routinely inspected, the products which are not supposed to be allowed into international commerce are blocked, North Koreans and North Korean leaders will feel that. I think that the U.S., South Korea, and China have in their ability to affect North Korean behavior in a way they have not done so before. And that should be their objective. I disagree with Farmer's Release comments about FAS. I think that's a very easy problem to solve. FAS has certain capabilities. The U.S. and South Korea are happy to have Chinese inspectors take a look at what these, and be briefed on what these systems can do, and what they'll find pretty quickly is that it's going to defend a missile from striking South Korea from North Korea. And perhaps it will defend, perhaps it will detect a missile from China in North Korea, at South Korea, rather, but they don't seem to be made such missiles. But it's not going to do more than that. It's the defense of South Korea, pure and simple. We all know why it's there. It's not because of some various resource designs. It's because there's a missile threat by nuclear power against South Korea. What are they supposed to do? Wait for the bomb to land in Seoul? This is not a matter of choice. This is not a matter of existence for South Korea. As for we talk about major power relationship. I thought it was a great concept. It was really proposed. We talked about it. What he had in mind was rising power, dominant power, the whole war. That was the whole core. That was my idea. After that, different people elaborated on different ideas of G2s and Corinthians, and then we lost its original meaning and it became unworkable.
Thank you, Janet. Mr. Moyne, 30 seconds. Would you like to?
No. I think just one part. I mean, while in the UN Charter, whether it's ASEAN, whether it's architecture, all these big debates, I think the key must be a pragmatic approach to finding balance of power in this part of the world. And I think without the pragmatism of recognizing challenges in play, large role, American presence is the key, and that many large countries in this part of the world are countries that don't pay. I think the challenge for us is how do we construct a pragmatic approach to building that local in-situ balance of our nation. I think it's sitting in the city of the economy. That realism is what must guide us, not this abstract theoretical debates on the future of great populations.
Thank you.
Yes, just very quickly, just listening to remarks and responses now, even deciphering intent is such a controversial and very complex matter. There are facts and there are perceptions. And obviously, there is a need to bridge this gap. And that's why I try to place emphasis on the importance of communications, managing crises, and even more probably even solving problems. But the things, as we are speaking here in Singapore, it's terribly important for ASEAN to deliver. ASEAN, there is a goodwill towards ASEAN's capacity, centrality, and leadership. And I hope in the years to come, ASEAN can deliver the kind of concrete suggestions how the current situation can be managed. Otherwise, we will become passive observer or even victims to this so-called green power relationship. And I was proposing specifically, we have the modality. The East Asia Summit is there. We don't have to reinvent it, but we need to empower it. We need to use it. And the idea of having a peace and security council within the East Asia Summit for countries to flesh out their problems and challenges, I think it's very, very important so that we can minimize these gaps. At the moment, unfortunately, the great powers are not behaving in a great way, and they are not behaving in a responsible way. And it takes the ASEAN countries to actually spread the benefits of ASEAN's practices and past, but this time beyond Southeast Asia. Otherwise, we'll have a confederation in this region to which ASEAN becomes a passive observer or even worse, a victim as well.
Thank you very much. We certainly have our work cut out, but I think this has been one of the most brutally honest and frank and clear-cut exposition of all of our positions on this issue. And I think it's the beginning of many, many more dialogues and very honest exchanges. Please join me in thanking our